Okay, thanks a lot for the introduction. So the, in fact, I debated when I knew I was coming here. I had to choose between two talks. And one of them, Pierre advertised this morning. So I don't need to talk about it. So now I can talk about the other one. So the other one is related to these beautiful pictures. And by the end of the talk, I hope I can tell you what they are and how we obtain them. But I'll go slowly because, in fact, these are supposed to describe how many? 12 groups. I think 12 groups. Or the fundamental domains for 12 groups. And two of them, well, these are all fundamental domains for lattices. Two of them are arithmetic. So if you get bored during my talk, just try to think which ones are arithmetic. So let me tell you a little bit of general background. So X is going to be, for the beginning of my talk and just for a few seconds, X is going to be a symmetric space of non-compact type. So non-compact type means non-positive curvature. It could have flats in a priori, but in a second I'll get rid of flats. But and G is going to be its isometric group. Well, okay, let me say up to finite index. Most of the time that's what will happen. Every now and then you could even have something further from the isometric group than just up to finite index. But I think I'll try to stick to that convention. And as you probably know, X is going to be a quotient of G by a maximal compact subgroup. Okay, now, so the main interest of object in my talk, object of interest in my talk will be lattices. So I'll spend a second defining that. So a subgroup. Gamma in G is called a lattice. This is not completely standard. In different parts of math, this means different things. But here, it means gamma is discrete. And the volume of the quotient. So you can take the quotient of anything you want. Either you take G mod gamma or G mod K mod gamma. This is the same thing. So I'll just write X mod gamma here. You want this volume to be finite. Okay. So one simple way, quote mark simple, way of making this volume finite is to take something where the quotient is compact. But okay, it shifts the difficulty, but you still, it's not so easy to come up with lattices. Okay, so the probably you know some examples, and you've seen a lot of them go by the last few days, I think. So I'll just tell you a handful of examples, and then we can discuss some more about what those are. So the simplest example probably you can take is SLNZ inside SLNR. Now, this is the isometric group of a symmetric space. Of course, for n equals 2, you know this very well, right? And bigger n, okay, it's slightly more complicated, but this always gives you a lattice. It's not completely trivial as it is. I like hyperbolic geometry, so the next simplest example is you do the same thing, but you take integer matrices, but that preserve a certain Hermitian form. So you take a standard Lorentzian form, and you take matrices with integer coefficients. This is a subgroup of SON1, and it gives you a lattice. Again, this is not completely trivial, but it's a fact. Now, of course, you can soup this up in many ways. One of the things is these give you non-co-compact lattices. Okay. And if you want to get, I should say what SON1 is, but you're going to take a Lorentz, so I said you take the standard Lorentzian form. Okay, so you take the subgroup of GLN, well, determinant one there, but that preserves this formation, this quadratic form. Okay, and this turns out to give you a non-co-compact lattice, but there's a trick, a standard trick in this business, that if you throw in some extra coefficient here. Then you can soup this up into something co-compact. So if you look at SOQ with entries in the ring of integers in a certain number field, then you still get a lattice there. So the point is, if the group is still the same, SOQ is the same as SON1. Right? This root 2 has absolutely no incidence on your group, but on the real group. But then the integer points change a lot here. So OK is the ring of integers in Q extended root 2. Now, it's not completely obvious that that this is a lattice, but let me just say that the key, so I should say this is a co-compact lattice. I don't want to give you a proof, but I just want to say that it's a lattice essentially because when you take SOQ cross SOQ sigma, where sigma, I define this as being K. So you take the automorphism of K, that's exchanging the root 2 and minus root 2, okay? The roots of the polynomial x squared minus 2, they're huge. Well, and you take this product here, it's pretty standard to see that this group is defined over the rationals. And you should think of the integer points in that group to be given by matrices with entries in the ring of integers there. And the key is that when you look at, I should say SOQ sigma is a compact group, that's the key. Okay, so one consequence is that when you take the projection onto SOQ, you have a projection with compact kernel, and it's easy to see that, it's a big theorem actually, but when you take integer points in here, you get a discrete subgroup. And because of the kernel is compact here, it's a consequence that the image is discrete also. So that gives you a proof of discreteness. You need to work a little bit to see that it has finite volume also. I will not do that, but we'll just remember this fact here, is that when you take, you take a quadratic form defined over a certain number field, and such that when you take its non-trivial Galois conjugate, you get something definite here. Or definite orthogonal groups give you compact groups. That's the key. Now, I should define what an arithmetic group is, and I will not, actually. I know I should, but unless really asked, I will not. So, in general, gamma in G, so I take any G as before, is called arithmetic. Or we discussed a number of pronunciation issues. How do we feel? Is it arithmetic? Arithmetic? So the stress is on the I? Okay, the arithmetic. Okay. Okay. Probably if I ask an American, we may get a different answer, so I don't know. In fact, probably there's a lot more Roman speaking, I don't know. Roman languages speaking people probably would not mind of the way I say arithmetic anyway. Let me just give you a rough definition, and if it is given as, let me say, h of z inside h of r for some group h defined over the rationals, up to some standard operation, so up to, commensurability. And up to taking these kind of homomorphisms with compact kernel here. Okay, so taking surjective homomorphism of the ambient real group with compact kernel. Okay, I could give you a more precise definition, but I think probably I'll make mistakes in writing it. I will not tell you the right conditions on G you need in order for this to make sense and so on. I think it's irrelevant. Okay, just keep this in mind. And I hope this is enough to follow the rest of my talk. If it's not, you will tell me and we'll discuss this some more. The important theorem is that most lattices are of this kind. Okay, so this is an important result of Margulis. If rank of x is at least 2, then every lattice is actually arithmetic. Every lattice, I should say irreducible. It is arithmetic. Okay, so this is a consequence of a big theorem. This is a consequence of superrigidity, which I'm probably not going to discuss too much today. But when I first heard this is a very problematic theorem. It influenced my whole career. So earlier on, it kind of kept me away from higher rank symmetric spaces in a way. Because I thought, okay, so the story is done there. We know everything. In fact, there's lots of things we don't know about lattices and about discrete groups and so on. I mean, it's a very interesting topic. But so anyway, because I heard about this a long time ago, I looked mostly at rank one symmetric space. In fact, in a second, I'll tell you, I'll be even more restrictive. So the rank one symmetric, symmetric spaces of non-compact type, let me write it this way. They come into four families. Okay, which I'm not going to describe in detail. Probably all of you have heard of these before, even though your students have, because they were here last week. Okay. These are not completely separate lists because there are some coincidences in low dimension. Most of the time, what I'm going to say, I'm going to take n to be at least 2 so that things are interesting. Otherwise, of course, H2R is extremely interesting, but I'm not going to say too many things about it. And there's a big theorem. So, of course, when you prove this, the techniques do not allow you to handle these things. Okay, but actually, superrigidity still holds in these two classes of groups. So lattices, superrigidity holds here. And in particular, you get the same result as Margulis. So lattices, they are arithmetic also. So every lattice. Lattices are all arithmetic here. But okay, so as you see, again, earlier in my career, I also heard about this. So I ended up thinking only about real and complex harmonic space. And there's many, many interesting things to do there, too. Okay, but, then in fact, it's not true in HNR, okay, but there are. NA is always going to stand for non-arithmetic. Okay? Non-arithmetic lattices in isom HNR for any N. This is a construction due to Gromov and Pietersky-Shapiro. I'll say a little bit more in a second. And then, of course, when you see this, everyone thinks, okay, the same thing has to be true for HNC. It's not known for HNC. It's not only in low dimensions. Of course, I mean, if you hadn't seen this line, maybe you'd think, okay, if it's true for quaternions and octonions, it should be true for real and complex too. But okay, that's not the case. And in fact, there are. The corresponding statement for HNC is not known. All that is known is that there are examples. In isom H2C and in isom H3C. So I will need to, so this is going to be, let me write holomorphic here. And the corresponding group is this PU21 here and PU31. for dimension 3. But in dimension 4 or higher, we have no example. So rather than telling you all the details about this construction, I just want to give you a rough idea how you construct lattices. Maybe I should say non-construction of lattices because, okay, of course, students here may find new ways of constructing them. I don't know. So I'll tell you a little panorama of what we know, but there may be many other ways. It's up to your imagination. So, of course, the basic thing is you can do arithmetic construction. This is, again, a very interesting subject. Okay, there's lots of things we don't know about arithmetic groups also, but I'm not going to talk about that today. Then Ruth told you yesterday about another nice way to construct an arithmetic lattice. One of them is you just use Coxeter groups or Coxeter diagrams. Okay, so I'll just show you an example. And if you get bored during my talk, same thing, try to prove what I'm going to write. So if you take, in fact, I never did it, I must say. I'm just quoting something that people quote all the time. So I never checked this myself. So you take this diagram. So the dotted line with the C here means that the corresponding hyperplanes are ultra-parallel, and I'm going to give you the distance here. So you take C to be square root of 3 cosine 2 pi over n minus 1. Okay, I have no idea where this formula comes from. I think probably I copied this correctly, but I don't even know. Okay, there's a formula like this. These are examples due to Makarov. And the claim is that for all but finitely many m, this is non-arithmetic. Okay, this is okay. It's not if you write any diagram like this, it's not clear that there exists a hyperbolic realization of this, right? So but the claim is that at least for I think for m bigger than 7, you get a hyperbolic group, and then this is non-arithmetic for all. Finitely many values of n. I don't know what the values are. Again, m bigger than 7. But okay. What's dimension 3? Dimension 3, in fact, I don't know of a similar construction in dimension 4. I wish I did, but so maybe some experts know about this. I don't know. Maybe Ruth would know. Okay, and I should say something that I believe Ruth, I'm not sure whether Ruth mentioned this or not yesterday. But actually, I don't know if I believe what I told you anymore. But no, I think this is okay. No, that's okay. Now, what I want to say is that, okay, this group is generated by 5 reflections, okay? And you remember what Ruth told you about what this diagram means, right? This means that the mirrors between the third and fourth generators there make an angle pi over 4. These make an angle pi over m. And these don't intersect. In fact, I gave you the distance between these hyperplanes. Okay? And the key is that you get a presentation for the group. It's generated by 5 reflections, such that, RK squared is always the identity. For any k between 1 and 5, then if you take R1, R2 to the m, you get the identity. If you take R2, R3 to the fourth, R3, R4 to the fourth. And I should also have a bunch of commutation relations because these nodes are not joined by anything. So you take RK, let's say RJ commutator with J minus K bigger than equal to 2. Okay? This actually gives you a presentation. This is a general fact. So all the relations you get in the group come from the reflection relations and the angle between the mirrors. Okay? In fact, the way you prove this is by showing that the corresponding polytope is a fundamental domain for a group. You use the Poincaré polyhedron theorem. Okay? And you know that this polyhedron is going to tile real hyperbolic space. And the tiling gives you this presentation for free with a little bit of work, but it's not. Okay, now The next one is, let me write GPS for Gromov-Piotrowski-Shapiro, or variations. And the basic idea, I'm not going to go much into the details, but what you do is you glue piece, you glue, let me just say, arithmetic pieces. It's not really important that they're arithmetic, but you glue pieces of hyperbolic manifolds along totally geodesic submanifolds. So let me draw a naive picture. In fact, it's not so, well, let me just put it this way. Okay, you take one arithmetic manifold that contains a totally geodesic submanifold and another one. So let's say that you have an M1 and an M2 here. And you suppose that they're really different. Okay, you want these two not to be commensurable. Then one way to do this is you, in a way, okay, I shouldn't, maybe I should draw this as being shady or being gray, the other one being white, because they come from different manifolds. Okay, you take pieces of different manifolds and you glue, you assume that there's a common interface to glue, and then you just glue them to each other. What you get is neither M1 nor M2. In fact, it's something complicated enough not to be arithmetic. Okay. So what I want to discuss briefly is, well, okay, what's left of this, these three types of constructions in SU M1. Now, as I mentioned, well, you can do the same trick with SUN1. Okay, you just take you just replace this by a Lorentz form. Okay, and you don't take just a real field, because that's not enough. You need to take a quadratic, an imaginary quadratic extension of this real field. Okay, but that's, there's a variation on this. So arithmetic constructions still work. Yeah, so I should have mentioned, I had a title in my notes that I didn't copy on the board, so I should have mentioned that this was the case of SON1. I should say that this Coxeter group's construction is kind of annoying because it works only until a certain dimension. Okay? So you will not get examples in all dimensions by doing this. Arithmetic, you will. Gromov-Piotrowski-Shapiro also. The description clearly shows that it's independent of the dimension there. But, and okay, now what about SUN1? Of course, again, you can do arithmetic also. That's pretty clear. Now, I'm going to call them just like people call them, complex reflection groups, but it's a very bad name. It should really be called rotation groups and not complex reflection groups. So the rotation groups is my own terminology. In the literature, everyone calls this complex reflection groups. The point is you try to do something like what we did over there. You write some Coxeter diagram. Now you have a little bit more freedom than what you do in a real hyperbolic case because, well, you have more freedom, less freedom at the same time. The important thing is that, let me draw a schematic picture. I have no idea how to draw it any better. So if you take the complex hyperbolic plane, there's two kinds of, in fact, let me write HNC for now. So, and look at totally geodesic submanifolds. Well, you don't have so many. I don't know if it's of course, but it's pretty natural, I think, to think that you will have copies of complex hyperbolic plates of smaller dimension there. And then it's pretty natural, I think, also that you will have real hyperbolic space, because you just take the real points. Think of this as the complex unit ball in CN with the appropriate metric, and then you just take the real points. That gives you a real ball, and that naturally carries the real hyperbolic metric here. Let me say in HKC inside HNC. And still, you are going to have a K less than n equal to n there. But the important thing being that nothing is going to bound in complex algorithmic space, because these are a very low dimension. This is codimension two in real sense. Okay, so none of them bound anything. Okay, so you don't have a good analog of worlds of these Coxeter diagrams. And, okay, people don't care about this so much. They take hyperplanes. Okay, they take complex hyperplanes. So I'm going to draw a picture for H2C. And I'll draw just I always draw the same picture because I cannot draw anything else. I'm sorry. The other ones are drawn by the computer. What I'm trying to draw here is three copies of H1C. Okay. Of course, okay. This is another thing I should say is that it would be natural to take H2R also instead of H1C. Okay, it just goes completely in a different direction than what I'm going to talk about today. Today I want to focus more on H1C. And when you look at isometries fixing a copy of H1C, well, you still have since it's codimension two, I think it's quite natural to think that you have a one parameter family of isometries doing that corresponding to rotations precisely. Right? So you're going to, I'm going to indicate it this way. You just take rotations around these copies of H1C. I don't know. It's probably irrelevant that I'd write a formula. But in fact, this is what Mostow did. So in a quite old paper in 1980. And he was investigating groups generated by three complex reflections. Now, as I mentioned, there is an angle of rotation. So the P here indicates that you take a rotation of order P. You take something that rotates by an angle 2 pi over P, actually. And then the node between these guys means that when you take, I can have any Q here, if I 1 or 2 or 3. And the edge joining these two nodes here means that when you take R1, R2 to the Q over 2, you get the same thing as R2, R1 to the Q over 2. So if Q here is an integer, not necessarily an even integer, I should say what it means when Q is odd. So if when Q is odd, R1, R2 to the Q over 2 means you take a product R1, R2, R1, blah, 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 blah. And you finish with R2, R1, sorry. And here there are Q factors, but they're not the same, right? Some of them are R1, some of them are R2. And Mostow was looking at a special case of this. He was taking Q equals 3 and some specific values of P. And he noticed that in there are some lattices, okay, and some of them are non-arithmetic. Okay. So let me make a word of caution here. So to say that that you have rotations R1, R2, R3 that satisfy this relation does not determine a group. Okay, when you have a Coxeter diagram like that, it may not. If you draw a random diagram, there will not exist a polytope with these angles. But if there exists one, it's unique. Okay. Well, okay. If you write random actually, this is not quite true. If there is one with finite volume, it's unique. Here it's not unique at all. Okay, if I fix these relations, okay, there's still a parameter up to conjugation. There's still, in fact, a one-parameter family of groups. Yeah. So the Coxeter diagram. So let me write this as a word of caution. So the complex Coxeter diagram does not determine the group. Uniquely up to PU to 1 conjugation. And in fact, there's, maybe it's not true for all PQ. I think it is, anyways. Okay, I'm not completely sure about that. But usually the typical situation is that you get a one parameter family, okay, typically. There exists a real one parameter family of representation. Okay, and you have continuous families of representations. In fact, most of them will not be discrete. Most of the time, not discrete. And sometimes they will be lattices, okay? But this is, so most of shows that. For well chosen. PQ plus the formation parameter. You get non-arithmetic lattices. Okay. And in fact, okay, I don't know if I want to say much more about that. I want to mention something else that I think will interest at least a handful of people in the room, is that you can do some kind of uniformization construction also. So you take, let me just, again, some of you are dozing off because it's just 2:30. It's the time for a nap, right? But let me give you a homework. A piece of homework so that you don't. So, in case you're falling asleep, wake up now and I'll give you homework. So, you take this configuration of line in P2C, okay? Complex projective space, and you take. Okay, if you want, you can change the configuration also, but. Okay, and the homework would be really hard if I didn't give you some hints. So, the hint is you take some weight, and in fact, what I really want to take is an orbifold. I want to take P2C. With weighted configurations of lines, okay? So at which line I'm going to assign a weight. These three have weight 2, the other one have weight 6. What I claim is that okay, I need to go to say a few more things, but okay, what I'm going to do is to blow up some of the triple intersections there. Okay, so you blow up at 3 points. You're going to have something slightly larger than complex projective space. Okay, and there's still going to be this 6, 6, 6. And then, okay, in fact, you don't have a choice for which weight you put on these guys here. It's determined by the configuration, but I'm going to give you some hint also. I'll give you 12 here. Okay, so the claim is that this orbifold is uniformizable by the ball. So this is, so this, what's the question?
The point which you have not blown up is
one point. Yes. You would like to blow it up or?
Yeah.
No, you need to blow this up because there's no smooth branch covering with order 6, 6, and 2 of this configuration of lines. Here there is. Actually, I really have to blow it up for these 3 points, but for that one I don't. If you blew it up, I don't know, you'd get a blown up ball quotient. I don't know what. I don't have much to say about what good that would be. But this is uniformizable. This is a ball quotient. Actually, this orbifold is a ball quotient. I should say is a complex hyperbolic orbifold. Okay, so your homework is not to show that because that would take you quite a bit of time, unless you already know many, many things. But how do you show that? Well, you have to compute characteristic classes. The point is there's a, so you have to compute the orbifold C1 squared of this of this orbifold and the orbifold C2. Okay. And in fact, this characterizes Bolle quotients. If you get that equality, you know that this is going to be a Bolle quotient. That's a big theorem. This, it relies on the solution of the Calabi conjecture by Aubin and Yao. Okay, so this is why the homework without telling you what to do would be a bit hard, I think. But anyway, this is much more general. So people have explored this. In fact, the name that I should mention here is Hirzebruch. Hirzebruch played with this quite a bit. I mean, he tried to list configurations that where you get this property.
That is the condition to be covered by the ball and compensate.
Yes, yes, that's right. In fact, okay, this is the same relationship as what CP2 does.
Yeah.
And H2C is the non-compact dual of CP2. So Hirzebruch proportionality tells you that you should have the same relationship for both portions. Now the tricky part is there's this orbifold here, but okay. So you have to know a little bit about orbifolds in order to be able to do this homework. Okay. But if you're bored and you know what orbifold or other characteristic is, you compute that. This one is a little bit trickier, but it's not so bad. I should say that from this picture, it's not clear whether the corresponding Bolle quotient is arithmetic or not. It's a bit hard. Okay. Well, in fact, I chose it so that people who know about this stuff actually can check very easily that it's non-arithmetic by looking just at total geodesic loci in there. So if you look at these lines there, we need to work a little bit harder, but you will see that the corresponding group corresponds to a 4, 6, 12 triangle group. And this turns out not to be arithmetic. So this gives you a sneaky way to show that it's not arithmetic. But it's in general very hard. I mean, this description will make it hard to check arithmeticity. Now, I should say what the champion construction is. Yes. Mahan, you have to speak louder. I'm deaf. I don't know. Okay, some of them do because, you use just the vibration. In fact, this clearly fibers over that P1. No? You just look at the vibration of, P2 minus a point there, fibers over P1. You look at the set of lines through a point. So it goes through the blow up, and sometimes you can get maps to Riemann surfaces that way. I don't know if this one works. It takes a little bit of work to check it. I used to care a lot about these things, and now I have drifted to other directions. But so let me tell you what the champion construction is. And it's the former champion construction, I should say. But it's, let me call it Dolin-Mostow and Thurston. And I don't want to say in detail what it is, but you just look at the moduli space of matrix, I should say flat matrix, on S2 with prescribed. Okay, flat matrix on S2 don't exist, right? You have to do something. It's going to be flat except for at some isolated points. With prescribed cone angle singularities. Okay, and it's Dolin-Mostow, using a very different description of this space, showed that this carries an HNC structure. Okay, whatever, so what you do is you fix the angle, you fix the number of cone angles, and you fix the angle there. And if you do it under some assumptions on the angles, you get a hyperbolic structure, a complex hyperbolic structure, and sometimes the metric completion is a complex hyperbolic orbifold for a lattice gamma. And it's fairly easy if you work through the construction to determine when these guys are arithmetic. Okay, so this gave the champion. So when you work this out, you'll get 9 non-arithmetic commensurability classes in PU21 and 1 non-arithmetic commensurability class in PU31. Okay. That's the limitation of this construction. Okay. Okay. So let me state what we did with I could state it as a theorem, but that's okay. I don't know if it's I like to write statements, okay? But I'll just tell you what the statements are. If I write everything out in detail, it would be very long. But so let me just state it like this. So it's a recent result. Maybe I don't know if I can even say 2015, right? I never know. I mean, it's okay. It's online anyway. It's published online. I don't know what the official date of the publication is, but we produce produce 9. It doesn't look right. Yeah, I think that's right. 9 more non-arithmetic lattices. It's 12 minus 2, if I, okay, 10 more non-arithmetic lattices. Okay, 10 non-arithmetic lattices, and at least giving at least 9 more commensurability classes. Okay. So, okay, the 10 non-arithmetic lattices we produced, none of them was in the Dolin-Mostow construction that we proved. And then almost all of them are different. There's just two of them where I don't know. Okay, so of course you notice that two of them look very much alike, you know? Okay, I will tell you what I mean by looking alike in a minute. But the point is the construction we did sees nothing a priori about the arithmeticity. Okay. Arithmeticity is a completely different check. When you'd want lattices, of course, you will not see the difference. This is the point of these pictures. They all look the same. And the commensurability classes are hard to spot, of course. This is there's some work there. I will tell you a little bit about how to check these things. So let me tell you a word about how we obtain these lattices. It's a long story. As I was saying before the talk actually started, it's hard to tell when this started, but it's a decade project, I think. You can say that. No? It started around 2005, fair to say. And the origin is, well, we played a lot with triangle groups. So but I'm going to say it slightly differently. So the origin, in a lot of ways, is triangle groups. Triangle groups are everywhere in this story. But so what I'm going to do is to take R1, a complex reflection. Again, I should call it a rotation, right? No one wants to call this a rotation, so I should take this opportunity to, okay, a rotation. Okay, you guys should all, these young people in the room should call this rotation. Okay. My angle, pi over p. And j is going to be a regular elliptic of order 3, like Pierre was mentioning in his talk this morning. Okay. And then I'm going to take R2, R3, which are obtained just the same way as these triangles there. It's going to be R1, R2, R3, except the R2, R3 come by conjugation by J. So you just take R2, it's going to be J, R1, R J inverse. R3 is going to be J, R2, J inverse. Now, this is, what's your middle name, Robert? This is John Robert, there needs to be a P for Parker. So, okay, let me tell you who P is. P is going to be R1J. And if you're bored, again, do this exercise. Actually, P cubed is R1, R2, R3. That follows from the definitions there. Now, if you want to parameterize isometric classes of pairs of rotation and regular elliptic like this, I'm going to assume it's not degenerate, probably. I want this complex line not to go through the fixed point of J here. But you can parameterize these groups by a trace. Okay, so let me write tau for the trace of R1J, trace of P. Trace of John, of Parker. Okay. And it's just like for Coxeter diagrams, does not always exist a configuration of these regular elliptics and a rotation there. With given P and tau, in general, it doesn't exist. There's a condition that's kind of not so complicated to state, but I don't really care about. So there are some conditions on P and tau for a group to exist. But if it exists, then it's unique up to conjugation. Okay, so now there's going to be a number of steps in what I'm going to tell you next. You're going to guess which choices of P and tau give a discrete group. Okay, so this took us 4 years, maybe. Then step two is you're going to check your guess. Okay. By constructing a fundamental domain. Now this took us another 4 or 5 years, I don't know. I mean, okay, we had candidate fundamental domain, it took us a long time to prove. Then step three. What's that?
Writing it up.
Yes. Okay, that's going to be step nine. So you're going to check arithmeticity. Step four, we're going to check commensurability. So my co-authors are they were very antsy when they discovered this. So in fact, we did step three first. Because of course we knew this would take a long time. So if you're going to spend a long time, you want to be sure it's worth it. Okay, so Julien actually spent he started by computing these guys and said, okay, if we find lattices, they're going to be non-arithmetic. Okay? And the difficulty was to prove that they were lattices. Okay, that's the really difficult part. Arithmeticity, you have to know how to do it. Commensurability, I think we were kind of lucky. Okay, so there's a nice necessary condition. I should say commensurability invariant. You take the field of traces in the adjoint representation. And we were lucky because these adjoint trace fields, this is not a complete invariant. Okay? I'm not saying that if you have the same trace field, you're commensurable. But at least if you're commensurable, you have the same trace field. And we were just lucky. This happens. There's just two groups there where you get the same trace field. And that's why I wrote 9 and not 10 there in this list. Okay, we don't know. Two of them, we don't know if they're commensurable. But so again, we were lucky about this. Let me just write check here. Arithmeticity, okay, there's a number of computations. How do we do this? Well, you have to justify that this is correct and this is not so obvious. But actually what you do, you write these groups as preserving. I could write Hermitian forms for you to give you homework. But okay, so if mu is e to the 2 pi I over 3p, you're going to have a Hermitian form. You can write these groups explicitly. So write alpha, beta, 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 and then you make this Hermitian. Alpha is going to be 2 minus mu cubed minus mu bar cubed. Beta is going to be, okay, and that I don't know off the top of my head. You have alpha mu bar squared minus mu tau. Okay, and R1 is very simple. R1 is just given by that formula, but it doesn't matter. And what you do is you compute, so these actually live in a number field. In fact, it's a you can make it a cyclotomic field if you want, and then you just apply cyclotomic automorphisms to the Hermitian form. You compute the signature of Galois conjugate. Okay. And the group is, you have to check that this is true, but the group is arithmetic if and only if the non-trivial Galois conjugates are, if there's at least one that's indefinite. Okay. Remember in the arithmeticity example I gave earlier, in the very beginning, arithmeticity was obtained by having only definite conjugates. Here, if there's one that's not definite, then you're done. What I said is not true as such. You have to be careful about which number field you use. And the number field you use is this adjoint trace field. Okay, you have to apply Galois automorphisms of, well, actually a quadratic extension of the adjoint trace field. But that's there's a criterion for this. So let me say check here. Let me tell you a few words about how we guessed, okay? Because I think that's a nice story. But and then I'll be out of time probably. But well, let me give you the baby version of step one. So, baby case for step one. Well, as I said, you're looking at a group generated by rotations. So just think of your simplest situations where you have two rotations. Let's say this is A and this is B. Okay. And I'm thinking of this, actually. I should say elliptic elements in H1C. Okay. And you just join them by geodesic. Now, if you want a fundamental domain for the action of B, you just take a sector like that. Fundamental domain for the action of A, you get a sector like that. In fact, to know whether this group is discrete or not, I'm assuming that this guy has angle 2 pi over p and 1 2 pi over q. Well, okay, you just look at the product AB. Okay. If AB is loxodromic, then this gives you a group of infinite covolume. If AB is parabolic, you get a lattice, but that's not co-compact. And then when AB is elliptic, well, you need to check whether it has finite order or not, whether it rotates by, so let me just say if AB loxo parabolic. I told you what happens. If it's elliptic, so if AB rotates elliptic and rotates by 2 pi over r, then you have a co-compact lattice. It's not quite a necessary and sufficient condition. Okay. If you have an elliptic element of finite order that does not rotate by 2 pi over r, it could still be discrete. By accident, in a way. But so anyway, I'm going to summarize this by saying that AB controls the group controls discreteness. It's a rough way of saying it. But now you do the obvious analog in our case. Okay, so you just so in our case, what we guessed is okay. Products should control the world. Should control discreteness. R1j and R1r2 control the discreteness. Okay, this is not true, but it's a rough idea. Okay, discreteness. You hope that this could give you something. Okay, it's neither necessary nor sufficient. Okay, it's just a way to guess what's going on. Okay, but this is what we did. I mean, this is you hope or you try. Like this. I mean, this is a silly idea, but actually it gives you something. So what happens is you just write down, okay, so tau is the trace of R1j. Now if you compute the trace of R1r2, you get something that you just compute. It's just tau squared minus 1. Now, if those are going to control your group, you need this to be the trace of elliptic elements of finite order. Okay, so you need to write this as something like e to the I lambda plus e to the I mu plus e to the minus I lambda plus mu for some lambda mu that are rational multiples of pi. Okay. So these are going to be roots of unity. Okay. And you do the same thing here. You're going to want, in fact, this is going to be real, so you want it to be 1 plus 2 cosine 2 theta for theta rational multiple of pi. Now take these two equations and solve them for tau. This is okay. I would never think of doing this, but John does somehow. I guess he's used to doing that.
Can you
What's that? Okay, so I'm lying a little bit. But anyway, okay, you ask John what you need to do. P equals, I'm doing the P equals 2 case, and then, it turns out that the answer is the same for P higher than 2, but it's for slightly mysterious reasons I never understand. But, and you solve it, you get something that, you get a relationship between these guys. So you need theta, lambda, and mu cannot be arbitrary, that's the point. You get a very strong restriction on lambda, mu and theta. So you get an equation like this. And, okay, thank you. You need to correct the preprint on your web page, I think. But, anyway, you get a sum of, remember you want lambda mu theta to be rational multiples of 2 pi. And you have a relationship between cosines there that has to be actually a very simple cosine, if you will. There's a this gives you a rational relationship between cosines of rational multiples of pi. Well, okay, if there's relatively few cosines, this is very restricted. So you just use this beautiful paper of Conway and Jones, classify these sums, the possible sums as above. As above with lambda mu theta in q pi. And okay, there's an infinite list. Okay, probably you can guess that because if you take supplementary angles, they have opposite cosines, no? So you can get silly relations there. So there are infinite families, but on top of that, there's discrete isolated families, if you wish. And this is what Julien and John had done when I joined the project. So you get that. If this, it's quite tricky, I must say, to use the Conway-Jones paper to get the list. Okay, it's quite, like I was mentioning John the other day, I tried to do this a while ago and I just started filling papers of computations. After 2 pages, I gave up and I thought, oh boy, this is what John had done already. So, and I don't know how many pages you need to do it, but it's pretty tricky. But so the point is that if this happens, then you get the solutions are of, let me say, 2 types. Either you get subgroups of Mostow groups. Which I don't care about because these are not going to give us anything new. Or tau is in a finite list, tau is in a, list of 18 values. This means I'm out of time. Here are the values, okay? They worked out this list, okay. Again, it's not so easy to do. The ones in small letters means I don't find any lattice there, so I don't really care about them. The ones in bold there actually contain lattices, but still you have to choose P, okay? So you cannot take P arbitrary there. Well, so these, you should remember that there's 3 relevant values of tau there, and there's 3 families there. Okay, actually there's 3 families on the left, 3 families on the right. These are the same pictures projected differently. The point is the Parker isometry there is regular elliptic. It has 2 invariant complex lines, and I'm doing orthogonal projection onto either one of these axes. So that's why there's 2 pictures. The one on the left corresponds to one axis, the other one. So these are the same pictures, really. At the bottom, it doesn't look like they're the same, right? Well, the point is the sum. So if you take p to the 5 in that case, you get a complex reflection. So there's a bunch of things that line up in one of the projections. Okay? It's a little bit difficult to understand as I say it, but it's actually quite natural. These are not quite fundamental domains, actually. They're invariant under p. Okay, and P has somewhat large order. In the bottom groups, there P has order 30. So this is why the picture is very complicated. It's invariant under an isometry of order 30. But actually, the combinatorics are not so bad. Okay, it's just you have a quite simple faces. Let me show you what the faces look like. I thought I was going to tell you what the numbers are on these edges of the polytopes. Let me just tell you in one word. So when I started playing with this, John was writing the pictures. He was drawing this picture by hand and drawing all these things by hand and so on. I never understood how he did it. So I spent, months asking him, but what are you doing, John? Okay, and now we finally understand this is why the computer can tell you the picture. Okay, the computer can draw everything because, okay, I think we have clarified it. We know exactly what John was doing. And we have a proof that these guys are lattices, that they are non-arithmetic, that at least 9 of them are new. And I think I'm going to stop here because I'm out of time.